Good evening, everyone, and welcome, especially on such a cold and blustery night. I think we've got an excellent lineup for you, so I hope you enjoy it. First, let me begin by acknowledging with respect the Lekwungen-speaking peoples on whose traditional territories the university stands, and the Songhees, Esquimalt, and Wasonic peoples on whose historic relationship with the land continues to this day. Welcome to Ideafest and the Faculty of Social Sciences event, Visual Storytelling, A Glimpse into World-Changing Research. I'm absolutely delighted to be here tonight, and as I said, I think we've got an excellent lineup of speakers for you. We did this last year, and we got so much feedback and people telling us you must do this again, so we took their advice. It's a little bit different, but more or less similar in principle. I know our faculty have been working very, very hard getting this presentation ready, because it's not the typical presentation that academics tend to give, so they were up for the challenge, and they've been working very hard on their stories. First up is going to be Alex here, Bordeaux-Fournier, from the Department of Anthropology. So if you can just sort of wave while I introduce you. Elizabeth Google from the Department of Economics. Jim Taneka from the Department of Psychology. Darcy Matthews from the School of Environmental Studies. Cecilia Benoit from the Department of Sociology in Carr, BC. Mycera Costa from the Department of Geography. And Sarah Weeb from the Department of Political Science. You should have a program in front of you, and you will see a short bio on each of our speakers. So each talk is going to be under 10 minutes in length, and at the end there's going to be a time that we've put aside for you to ask some questions. It's always the most interesting part of the evening when we get to engage with our audience. So it's my pleasure now to be able to introduce you to our moderator tonight, Jeremy Loveday. And we're really excited. We had the honor of having him as a moderator last year, and he graciously agreed to give up his time for tonight as well. He's a word performer and poetry slam artist, and most recently a city councillor. So we're really pleased to have him here tonight. So please welcome Jeremy.
Thank you very much. Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming. We have an amazing evening ahead of us. I'm really excited and honored to be here as the MC and to get to introduce all of our very talented researchers who will be speaking tonight. Storytelling is powerful. Ultimately, it's how we understand ourselves, and it's how we understand each other, and it's how we understand the world around us. And tonight, we have the honor of hearing stories from some of UVic's most brilliant researchers. Last week, I hosted a workshop for all the presenters about working more personal narrative and vulnerability into the sharing of their research. And that was very challenging for me as a facilitator. I don't often get to be in a room with people who are much smarter than I am and get to talk to them about their research. And so that was a real honor for me. And tonight, we will go on a journey through 7 short stories into fascinating research, which will use images to illuminate these stories. And it's going to be a really amazing night. So we've got our first presenter, and that's Alex Boudreau-Fournier. She's in anthropology. And Alex is a visual anthropologist interested in how sound, including music, connects with social life and with media. Through her research, she addressed questions such as, how does sonic design shape our experience of everyday life? And today she's doing something a little different, and I'm really excited to hear it. Her presentation tonight is called In Search of Yamaya. Give it up for Alex, everybody.
Okay, good evening. Thank you very much for being here. Imagine yourself in the street of Santiago de Cuba, 45 degrees Celsius in the shade. It's warm, you're by yourself, you're alone, you don't know anybody. Everybody's out because it's so hot inside. People sit on the sidewalk and you walk, and everybody knows you're not from the neighborhood. Everybody look at you. So that was me in 2002. At the time, I didn't speak a lot of Spanish, but I kind of managed. And I was in Santiago at the time because I was starting a new research. It was at the time my MA, my master research, about a group of dance and music called the Tumba Francesa. I had read a little bit about that group of dance and music. I knew very little about it, but I knew I wanted to know more about it. I also knew that the president of that group of dance and music, her name is Andrea Chialavenet, was a very strong woman, and that she was very protective of the knowledge of her community. And I was extremely intimidated, even though I didn't know her, never met her. I was very nervous about introducing myself to her, because I knew that all of my research depended on her liking me and on her allowing me to know about her and to know about that group that she had been leading for so many years. So I was in Cuba for 4 days already. I was waking up in the morning and I was asking myself, is it today the day that I will go introduce myself to Andrea? And I was literally pushing myself out of the bed, you know, like, Alex, let's go, like, come on, do it, you can do it. Going out and taking that same street that you see here, just down the hill, maybe four corners from that exact scene. Walking, everything is cool. Hola. Oh my God, I wanted to die. Arrive at that headquarter of the Tumba Francesa. Big colonial house, like almost falling apart. Look around, okay, it's time to go. No, I can't do it, I can't do it. I was so nervous, how I'm gonna present myself, how I can tell Andrea what I wanna do, that I'm a student in anthropology, that I wanna know more about her group, how can I make sure that she's gonna like me? And I was like, okay, Alex, you made it up to the headquarter today, let's take a break. So I went back home. But the fifth day, I was like, okay, come on, you have to do it. Went down the same street, same scene, same heat, same people. Hola, hola. Arrive at the house. That was the time. Talk, talk, talk. Not in French. Or knock, knock, knock. In English. And I hear the voice of a woman. It's open. Come in. Entra. Enter. And that's when I see that woman. What? There it is. Standing there at the end of that empty room where there was the Tumba Francesa. This is Andrea. I knew it was her just by the way she was standing, her charisma, I knew it was her. She was with her two sisters and she was standing just beside the religious altar in the corner of that meeting place. So I arrived close to her and to them, they look at me, kind of, ¿quién tú eres? Who are you? You know, what do you want? A foreigner, what do you want? So I did my best. My voice was shaking a little bit like right now. Hola, I'm a student in anthropology. I want to get to know what you're doing. I want to know more about your passion, about your music. I want to spend time with you, basically. And they didn't say anything. And they said, well, we have a rehearsal. The only thing she said is that we have a rehearsal every night on every Tuesday and Thursday night. So you can come and you know, see what we're doing. I didn't have to say more than that. Muchas gracias. Like, you know, like, and it's funny because I'm telling you that right now, but when Andrea and I now we think about that time, we laugh so much about it, you know, because she remembers how stressed I was when I entered the rehearsal room. So I went there for 6 weeks, every Tuesday and Thursday night, very religiously attending all of their rehearsal, looking at the dance, the music, the song. And after 6 weeks, Andrea came to me and she said, Alex, now that you've been here for 6 weeks, you probably know all the dances better than us because you've been watching us for that whole time. Do you want to join us for the carnival? Do you want to dance with us? Oh, wow. That was, for me, the best thing in the world. Of course I want you. And then Andrea made for me this wonderful dress that I have here. I didn't wear it. So that's my dress of the carnival that she made. This is aluminum foil paper, by the way. And so I went to the carnival, and everybody were calling me la estrella del carnaval, the star of the carnival. Not because I was dancing well, believe me, but because I was the only white person around. And it was a marvelous thing for me because I was not just looking at what they were doing, but I was really performing what they were doing and feeling the stress, the anxiety of performing for the carnival. It's been 15 years that I know Andrea. I have witnessed many important events in her life, the birth of her grandson, the recognition of the Tumba Francesa as an intangible heritage of the humanity by the UNESCO, and the death of her husband, Flavio. She also witnessed many things in my life, and it is amazing to have that person in a life where you share so many events, significant events. Yemaya is a divinity in Cuba that is part of the Yoruba Afro-Cuban religion, and she's associated with the sea, with the ocean. She is represented often in popular culture by a siren. She's all dressed in blue. She's considered as being the owner of the waters. Her punishments are hard, and her anger is terrible, but she always acts with justice. Andrea is a spiritual daughter of Yemaya, which means that Andrea feels she has a particular attachment to this Orisha, or to this divinity. Andrea has a religious altar in her house dedicated to Yemaya. In many ways, Andrea makes me think about the Orisha Yemaya. In Search of Yemaya refers to my continuous desire to build and maintain a long-lasting relation with Andrea, a relationship based on care and love. In Search of Yemaya is a friendship, a mother-daughter type of relation that began 15 years ago, the day I had the courage to knock at the Tumba Francesa headquarters door and introduce myself to Andrea. Anthropology is about creating sincere relationships with people you meet, yet those relationships take their life on their own, and we never know where they might lead you. Searching for Yemaya has been, for me, a beautiful gift of life. Thank you very much.
Wow, give it up one more time for Alex Boudreau-Fournier. And thank you. That was. Were you all transported to Cuba like I was? Yeah, you could feel it. And that's the power of story. So if everyone's finding a seat, that's good. Our next presenter is Mycira Costa. And Mycira leads a lab in the geography department that is the first of its kind in Western Canada. Her remote sensing lab investigates spectral characteristics of the ocean, focusing on the interaction of light energy with organic and inorganic material in water. And her presentation tonight is called The Color of Our Oceans. Please give it up for Mycira, everybody.
Thank you. So we'll continue to talk about the ocean, but with a slightly different way of looking at the ocean. So the first thing that I would like to point out is what comes to mind when you think about the color of the ocean. I want you to think about it for 1 second. Okay, and to help you, I want you to look at this picture. So you see blue waters, right? Do you think about summer vacation, going swimming, something that we would love to do because we have a long winter this year, right? So it would be great. So I kind of think the same. So raise your hands if you think about summer vacation when you see these pictures. A few people, not everybody. Some people think differently. I think about this. What about brown waters? When you look at brown waters, maybe the impressions are a little bit different. Maybe you are thinking about, oh my God, there's sewage coming to the water. I don't know if I want to swim there. It's too brown. What about red waters? I don't know if many of you have seen waters red like that. It's becoming more and more common in our coast now. And maybe you will think, whoa, should I be swimming these waters or not? This gentleman is definitely taking his time to think, well, maybe I should go, maybe I should not go. I wouldn't go if I was him. But anyways, I think the same way as maybe the majority of you think about when you look at the color of the water. But I also think a little bit different, and that's what I'm going to talk about right now, is when I look at the water color, I can think about what kind of information I can derive from the water color that it's important for us to understand what's happening in our oceans. So I think about what we call harmful algae blooms. And this is a snapshot of CBC News from 2015. And you may have seen that. At that time, we had the largest harmful algae bloom happen all the way from California to Alaska. Was the largest one ever measured. And you can see there from the picture, the water is a little bit reddish. This is caused by algae in the ocean. And we're seeing this more and more often. In 2015, there was closure of the shellfish industry from California all the way to the British Columbia coast. And this had enormous impact, economic impact in the business. So the call of the water somehow is related to us, societal needs. This was caused by a microscopic algae called Pseudonychia. So tiny little guy, like those little things that you see in the screen there. And that caused this change in the water and caused the massive closure of the shellfish industry with some implications for the salmon industry as well. This year, or 2016, more recently, I don't know if you've witnessed that. Raise your hands if you heard of this green waters in the Strait of Georgia. I think a lot of people saw it. You just need to take the ferry or be in one of the Gulf Islands and you would be seeing this. So the waters turned bright green. This, again, was another algae, bloom of another algae, called a coccolith 4. So slightly different one, not harmful for fish and shellfish. But this bloom was unexpected, and it's the first time that you had a large bloom such as this one in the Salish Sea. So these are new events that we're observing more and more often on our coast for different reasons. So when I look at the color of the water, I think about what is causing the change in the color of the water. Most of the time is the presence of some algae, in this case, phytoplankton. So the color of the water changes according to different constituents or different particulates in the water. One of them is the phytoplankton, which is the base of the food web. So it's the supermarket starts with the phytoplankton in the ocean. And it's the vegetable of the ocean. So it's every single organism after the phytoplankton depends on the existence of the phytoplankton. When I look at blue waters, which you see in your left side there or on your right side, I think about not enough food for the fish. When I think about green water, but not the green waters from last year, a slightly different kind of green, I think about that's great, lots of food for the fish. When I think about brown water, I also think perhaps not enough food for the fish. That's likely close to a river. So these are different interpretations of the color of the water. So red can be harmful, brown can be a river, blue, not enough food, green, very good food for the fish. That's important for us. It's very important on the coast here because one of the things that we've been witnessing in the last 30, 40 years is a large decline on the salmon population. And I'm highlighting here just two species. One is the coho and chinook. And what you see there is the survival rate decline. It doesn't matter where you are in the Salish Sea for these two species. And I can put the same plot for sockeye and we'll see exactly the same. And there are several hypotheses what's possibly causing this decline. One of them is the productivity of the ocean. And that's one of the things that we're trying to investigate. To have this information in a scale that is required to understand why the salmon is declining, we use the ocean color. How do we measure the ocean color? Now we understand the ocean color is related to the different types of plankton in the water. It's also related to the amount of plankton in the water. And the plankton is the base of the food web in our oceans. So what we do is look at the ocean color and we derive information about ocean productivity. That's good. So how do we do that for a very large area? We use satellites. And I'm going to show to you a small time series of satellite image acquired in last year, in July, August, showing the different colors of the Salish Sea, acquired by a satellite called MODIS. So these satellites are about 800 kilometers above the Earth's surface. If you look at the Salish Sea, you're going to see the different colors of green and blues and whites. The whites are clouds. So, and from this type of information, we can derive the productivity of our oceans. When I look at the ocean color, I also think about art. And I'm sure you're all like, wow, this is amazing. Isn't it amazing, this picture? So, this is acquired by a satellite. Again, this satellite is called Sentinel, and it's above 700 kilometers above the Earth's surface. And this is an image acquired by the Sentinel satellite over the Baltic Sea in 2015. And it's incredible how artistic it is. And the artist is another phytoplankton species called cyanobacteria. So I'm showing to you the different types of phytoplankton or algae in the water and how they change the color of the water. And we use all the information to understand how productive our ocean is or if there's anything harmful for all the species in the ocean. So the artist here is the cyanobacteria that produce this kind of pattern pattern in the ocean, and the satellite was capable of acquire that when it measures the color or how much light is coming from the ocean. And
thank you.
And if you look at this paint from Van Gogh, you will see a lot of similarity between Van Gogh and the cyanobacteria. So they are very artistic, just different artists. Thank you.
My Sierra Costa, everybody. Thank you for shifting the way that I look at the colors of our oceans. Our next speaker tonight is Jim Tanaka. And Jim examines cognitive and neurological processes underlying object and facial recognition. Most recently, he has been working with children with autism to improve their facial recognition using computer games developed in his lab. And his talk tonight is called About a Face. So please give it up for Jim, everybody.
Thanks, Jeremy. Well, hi, welcome. Thanks so much for having me. I really want to take this opportunity to talk a little bit about something different. So Jeremy challenged us to sort of reveal something about ourselves that nobody else knows or something. So I decided to do that, and we'll see how it works. Okay. I'm a cognitive psychologist. I study the inner workings of the mind and how we recognize faces and recognize objects. I'm also interested in what happens when we can't recognize faces. And that's with kids with autism. It turns out that they have a hard time recognizing faces and emotions. So I'm really interested in that. But also, I'm a Canadian-American and a third-generation Japanese Okinawan. And I want to talk a little bit about that as well. Okay, so let's first think about faces. And we know faces are special. It's certainly the first thing a newborn infant sees when she comes out of the womb. It's probably the face of her mother. We also know that by 30 minutes old, an infant will look at a face more than any other object. So faces really are something that's biologically hardwired. We also know by day 4 that this developing newborn will be able to recognize her mom's face over any face of a stranger or even dad, turns out. Okay, so faces seem to have this special status in the kind of objects we can recognize. And yes, it's true. I mean, there's certain neurostructures that are dedicated to recognizing faces. Well, faces have a lot of information. So if you think about what kind of information is conveyed in a face, well, we can get some insight into what a person's feeling, because their facial expression is often a mirror of their internal emotions. So we can know if a face is happy, maybe a face that's angry, a face that's perplexed, a face that's disgusted, a face that maybe might be sad or surprised. So these are all kind of the facial emotions that we can sort of discern by looking at somebody's face. But faces are also important for our identity, because it's really through our faces who we are. It's the uniqueness of our personhood. And faces as perceptual objects are pretty interesting, because when you think about it, all faces are made of the same pieces. We all have two eyes, a nose, and a mouth, but it's those sort of subtle contours of those features that really distinguish one face from another, as well as sort of the skin tone and the textures. But all those are the perceptual cues to who we are, and we're all really different. And so the face is really the signature of our identity. Well, you can think about faces as individuals, but then you can also think about faces as groups. And they actually form perceptual categories. So if you think about a face, we get lots of information of our sort of our affiliations. So we know how old people are by looking at their face. We certainly get some insights into gender and sex. But we also get lots of important information about a person's race. Now, there's lots of debate as to whether or not race is really a biological or a social, socially constructed concept, and I really don't want to get into that today, but no doubt that when we look at somebody, we can categorize them, or we think we can categorize them in terms of their race. Now, that could be a good thing in the sense that it gives us a sense of affiliation, but it also can be exploited. So in social psychology, there's something called in-group, out-group. So in-group's all the people you hang out with. The out-group is all everybody else. And this dynamic of in-group, out-group can also be politicized, and we know that because it's been exploited in cartoons. So so a face is sort of, when you think about a stereotype, it's sort of the opposite of individuation. It's sort of taking out the uniqueness of a person and treating them as just a sort of a de-individuated member of some other group. And that's basically what these sort of cartoons and caricatures do. It's kind of interesting. I was sort of doing research for this talk and stumbled on that the picture in the middle was done by Dr. Seuss. So somebody, you know, associated with, you know, very positive children's books, is actually part of the wartime propaganda machine. The color picture in the upper right there is actually is taken from one of the Disney cartoons. So I think this idea of objectifying people by race is not so unusual. Probably one example of how race has been used is for sort of political means was the internment of Japanese Americans and Japanese Canadians during World War II. So in 1941, there was Pearl Harbor, which was a very galvanizing moment in the history of the United States and Canada. And that served as sort of the sort of, trigger for interning 150,000 Japanese Americans and Japanese Canadians in placing them in internment camps. Now, it's sort of interesting because why Japanese people? Because we were also at war with Germany and Italian. But I think one can make an argument that sort of the way we look is determined who got interned. So there was the executive order in the States of 1966. In Canada, it was the War Measures Act. And essentially, it was a notice that gave Japanese Americans and Japanese Canadians 48 hours to pick up all their things and to board a train and to be taken to these internment camps. In Canada, the internment camps were east of the Rockies. So this was a security measure because the governments were afraid that the West Coast Japanese would somehow collude with the Japanese and undermine the war effort. So that the Japanese Canadians, Japanese Americans were placed in these camps that were not much better than your prisons. So actually, my grandfather was from Juneau, Alaska, just to show you how thorough they were. Somehow, my grandfather ran a restaurant in Juneau, but the FBI were able to locate him, and in the middle of the night, took him away from my his family, and they were reunited about a year and a half later. So this internment process was very thorough. And to document the internment process, the government hired Dorothea Lange to take photographs of the internment experience. The government wanted to have some documentation of that process. Well, it turned out, though, she is such a fine photographer, she was able to capture sort of the feelings and the mood of people in the camps and their faces and what they were experiencing. And when the government saw the photographs that she was able to take, they actually impounded the photographs and put them in the National Archives. And it was only until, I think, 2007 where they were released to the public. But you can tell, looking at the young girl's face or the face of the grandfather, that these were not good times in the internment camp. So that's about, you know, faces, and faces are so powerful. But they can also be used for good. So there's an amazing project done by the visual artist JR. And what he did was this was back, I think, sometime in 2005, perhaps, where there's, you know, lots of conflict, obviously, between the Palestinians and Israelis. But he came up with this idea of the face-to-face project. So what he did is he took pictures of Palestinians and pictures of Israelis and blew them up huge, big size. And he got lots of different people, but he got sort of the religious leaders from the different communities. And what he did was he had them make silly faces, and he had this kind of fish eye lens to even exaggerate the facial expressions to make them even look more ridiculous. And then what he did with these huge photographs is he put them on the separation wall between Israel and Palestine. And he put the Palestinian pictures on the Israeli side and the Israeli pictures on the Palestinian side. And just as a way to humanize faces. And so that this was his kind of attempt to sort of bring some humanity to that conflict. And so I think that all speaks sort of to the power of the face, so that a single face can change everything.
Give it up one more time for Jim Tanaka, everybody. And thank you for being courageous and trying something different. It was definitely... It was an amazing story you told, so thank you for stepping out. Our next speaker is Cecilia Benoit, and Cecilia is a sociologist and scientist with the UVic Center of Addictions Research of BC. She was recently awarded the Governor General's Award in commemoration of the Persons Case for her groundbreaking research with vulnerable groups, from at-risk mothers in Victoria to sex workers across the country. She studies the health of people who do sex work and the stigma that they face and the way that that stigma impacts their health and their lives. Today she's presenting on the health of vulnerable populations. Please give it up for Cecilia, everybody.
Great to be here. Sorry, I had to keep this in front of my mouth. So I'm going to talk a little bit about stigma and my own personal experience of it, and then relating it to sex work. So first I wanted to ask, has any of you ever experienced being shunned in public or in the media? Being called out, put down? Yeah. So that's kind of what we call the ouch factor, you know, like that really hurts. You can't really put your finger on it, but something really, really hurt you emotionally. So I want to give you a story about myself and then link it to some of the research that I've been doing. So way back in 2002, I was invited by Peers Victoria to do research on sex work in Victoria. They had no idea who was in the industry and what people were doing and how they got in and what were the conditions of their work. So I had done research on women, gender, and work, and so I worked with them. So we got some funding from the Canadian Institute of Health Research, so national research, to actually do a fairly large study comparing sex workers, people who work in the hair industry, and people who work in food and beverage. What we're interested, really, was to understand the impact of stigma on people's lives, because all of those groups of people feel some belittlement. You know, when you go to a party, you don't feel always that great to say, "Oh, I work as a, you know, in the hair salon, or I work at the Burger King or something." Right? There's a little bit of feeling negative about that. But then think about when you say, "Well, I'm a sex worker." Well, will people ever say they are? It's something. So UVic had a little media release about this study. And someone from the Times columnist picked it up, a guest editor, and wrote this, you know, this paragraph saying, "How dare Canadian taxpayers' money be used to study sex workers compared to tax-paying, hardworking, morally upright women?" So, and then it went right across the country. Every newspaper picked it up. Canadian Institutes for Health Research called me and then wrote a reply. So that was fine. And the next day I go to work and I get an envelope in my sociology mailbox. And on the back of it is a lot of words. And the words basically said something like, "Dear Dr. Benoit, regarding the study, they call me a psychologist, bartender, hairstylist, prostitute. Instead of raising the status of women, you are degrading them, or are you not one of them yourself?" So that was what I felt that at that moment is something called courtesy stigma, stigma by association, where the stigma attached to a particular group that you are studying gets passed on to you, and it hurt and I didn't know what to do at the first. And then I said, okay, I'm going to write an op-ed, and of course I've got power, I've got privilege, I'm a professor, so I could throw it off pretty quickly. So I wrote an op-ed to Times columnist, and they published it, but on top of it they put a picture of a faceless woman. Jim, I'm gonna connect with you. In the back, and I said, "Why are you putting that picture there? Because that has nothing to do with the story." What the story was about, that everybody in Canada deserves health and health care, and we need to understand people who are vulnerable and hidden in the society. And they said, "Well, that's how we sell our papers." So that was fine. And then, and there was 25 years of scholarship on the sex industry, some that I did, some other people did. I just took this picture in my office today just to give you an idea of the numerous, and some negative, but by and large, research showing the diversity of people involved in the industry along gender lines, reasons why, and how they compare to other occupations, and so on. So gigantic literature that has developed over the 25 years period. But last week I had one of my studies presented in the media, and it went in all the major newspapers, and Linda Giftash wrote it, and she actually read the full article. She wrote a really, really honest article. But there's these legs and no faces again. That's like 25 years later. Or not 25, 15 years later. And so I asked Lynn, I said, "Why are those legs the only stock picture that people use?" And her answer for me was, sells the newspapers. And also she said, the public, the newspaper or the media people think that's what the public want to see. And I asked you that question, is that really the case? And when we look at surveys on what Canadians think about the sex work, is whether it should be decriminalized or not, we get increasingly people responding, 60-70% saying, if it's a consenting adults, you know, let's leave people alone and not criminalize them and not stigmatize them. But yet the media continues to have this image of people. So how do we challenge stigma? So my point in a lot of my research is that stigma is mutable, it can be changed, it's not, those legs don't always have to be there, and even if they're there, you can, there's still other ways of telling the story besides that faceless picture. And so the stigma literature, actually a lot of the best work is done on mental health, and the way that you change attitudes of other people and how, why they separate themselves from others and why they feel that they have a right to put people down. You can change it by, of course, having real life pictures with faces and emotion. And using words, of course, are important. For people with mental illness, they actually use humor as a really, really important tool to communicate with audiences. And the third is human contact, physical contact. It's hard, much harder to only think of someone with legs when you meet a real person and you realize, actually, that person knows my sister, or that person actually is someone who I just served in the restaurant, or something like that. So human. So this is actually a picture from Piers Victoria, and we see there is actually two former directors and one of the volunteers that work there. And so sex workers are not taking this thing of sitting down. They're organizing. They're actually really able to actually what we call like turn the stigma back on the stigmatizers, and the greater opportunities they have to do that, then they become empowered, and then their voices get heard. So that's my little story. I have actually shown this to my students, but I've never ever shown it in public before, but I keep it, cherished it. I have it in my office, and it's something, whenever I feel like I understand what sex workers are going through, I go in, I take a read, and then I actually feel that emotion again. So thank you.
Cecilia Benoit, everybody. Yes. An amazing talk, and it's a reminder that that poster, that sign is actually in my office at City Hall, and I need to return it to Piers, so it's a good reminder. And so if every year there's the Red Umbrella Walk, so if you'd like to help stomp out stigma for sex workers, you can encourage you to support Piers and join the Red Umbrella Walk. And I will get those signs back to Piers. Our next speaker is Darcy Matthews. And Darcy is an ethnoecologist and archaeologist who works in collaboration with First Nations communities to understand the deep history of social and ecological relationships between past peoples and their environments. Darcy's in environmental studies, and his talk today is called Kletchis, Relatives of the Deep. Please give it up for Darcy, everybody. Great, thank you. It's good to be here. So, do you know what this plant is? Blue cannabis. Many of you know this plant. This is familiar to many or most of you who go through walks in the springtime. What I'd like to do is I'd like to do a bit of a rambling story. And I'd like to begin my talk by talking about what I call my blue camas moment.
When I was doing my master's degree many, many years ago, I considered myself a stones and bones archaeologist. I studied stone tools and I studied funerary practices. I was working with the Coast Salish community in Beecher Bay, the Shiana Nation, and I was looking at their burial practices, their funerary practices, by looking at a certain kind of burial, these burial cairns and burial mounds, these above ground burials. And working with cultural workers in that community and other Coast Salish communities, I followed the protocols and the values around their dead, which meant not disturbing the graves, and it challenged me to incorporate sort of Coast Salish worldview and blend that with a scientific one. But I had much to learn. As I was recording these burial cairns, I noticed in the springtime, and I was out there for a very, very long time, maybe a little bit too long according to some of my committee members, but at the same time, I spent so much time, spring, summer, fall, winter, with these burial cairns, and I saw the ebb and flow of the seasons. And in the springtime, I noticed around my burial cairns, the burial cairns I was working on, that these purple plants would come up. And it shocks me a little bit to admit this, or shames me a little bit to admit this, but of course, being a newcomer to this territory way back when, I pulled one of them out and took it home and looked it up. I went and got a book by Nancy Turner and looked it up and saw it. This is blue camas, and I saw that this is, you know, this incredibly managed plant that for many thousands of years the Lekwungen and Coast Salish people have been managing through weeding and burning. It's a very important food, probably the most important food in their community. And it made me realize that as a scientist, the things that I'm studying are surrounded by a larger world. And as scientists, we often get focused on a very specific thing or a very specific problem. And the camas, I looked beyond the camas and I saw this lumacia, a little beautiful yellow flower. I realized that this plant is called kakmin, and that the seeds from that plant are burned as an incense during funerals. And I looked beyond those and I saw these Douglas fir trees, and the bark from those trees had clearly been removed, and the bark from those trees was used culturally as well. And I began to realize that these burial cairns inhabit a landscape. A landscape that isn't easily bounded and isn't easily studied by the kind of science that we do. At the same time, working for many years with Coast Salish cultural workers, many of them experts in plants, it schooled me in a way. And sitting with those burial cairns and in the seasons, watching the ebb and flow of tide, looking at the village sites, it began a second kind of parallel education. An education of place, an education in a different culture and in a different worldview. And I became entangled by blue camas, and I became entangled by these landscapes. And one of the things I would like to do is to maybe try and share this blue camas experience with you as a sort of an opportunity to make you or provoke you to think about your own perceptions of place and landscape as well. So, a couple of years ago, I was approached by Nancy Turner, an ethnobotanist that I'm sure many of you know about, and she was invited to go out to Clichis. Clichis are the archipelago of islands right off the southern tip of Cadbro Bay. If you go down to Cattle Point, those are the islands you look at. And Clichis was a place where her good friend from the Songhees Nation, Sathlama, or Joan Morris, was going to share her name with Nancy. And in the Coast Salish worldview, or Coast Salish culture, names are a kind of property. They have a historic trajectory to them. The names are family property, and they're transferred from descendants through time. And they link names and places through this unbroken sequence. And to share a name was a great honor. And I was asked to come and witness this. And witnessing these important or momentous events is also a very great honor to be invited to do this. It was really the first time I had a chance to spend time with Nancy, and it's really the first time that I had a chance to spend time with Sathlama. And during the course of that day, we had a traditional pit cook, and we were cooking salmon and potatoes and this traditional meal. And I began to talk with Sathlama. I was still finishing up my PhD, and I had postdoc plans that didn't involve Clichis. But talking with Sathlawa this time and then many times since, I began to realize that like Blue Camas, like other elders I've worked with, I felt this shift, this seismic shift in my life starting to take me into a new direction. I finished my postdoc and started a position here at the University of Victoria with the full intention of now working primarily with Sathlawa. And Sathlawa was very excited about this opportunity. We've only been 6 months working on this project, but I'd like to share some of what we've already learned about these islands. Sathlawa was the last generation to live at Clichés. Clichés is a derivative of the Lekwungen word Tlatlachis. And Tlatlachis, according to my language teacher, Linda Elliott, translates to the phrase relatives or ancestors of the deep. And I love the way that kind of resonates with Clichés for Sathlawa and many of the other Songhees or Lekwungen peoples today, that in a largely urban society or community, living in a place that they don't have a lot of intensive historical connections to, Clichés is that ancestral place that they still own. They've had to leave it about 60 years ago, but it's a place that Songhees Nation still calls home, and Sathlawa calls us home. It's part of a triangle in a sense. If you actually go down to Cattle Point is sort of one of those points of the triangle. To this side is Cadbro Bay, to this side is Oak Bay, and on the far side is Clichés. And they form this triangle of village sites and these blue camas gardens, these really intensive managed landscapes. These are the Lekwungen homelands. And of course, the uplands and most of Victoria is very urban. And Clichés is the last sort of unurban landscape that the Songhees have left. So the work that we're doing honors the history of Clichés. Clichés for Sathlawa and for the Songhees people has always been a place of healing. Joni's or Sathlawa's grandparents were healers. Tom and Alice James were famous healers. And her great-grandfather, Ned, was a famous Indian doctor, a shaman, a traditional healer. And for Sathlawa today, she still sees Clichés as a place of healing. But I think in her sense, a place of cultural healing, a place to go home to. And that's Sathlawa's vision, is to get people back onto the landscape. And this is a picture here of Tom and Alice James. Sathlawa's in the middle. And there is Sathlawa standing at Clichés with a picture she's holding. It's actually a picture of her grandma, the original Sathlawa. The work we're doing is, I think, a fairly unique blend of ethnoecology, so looking at the way people manage landscapes over time, and archaeology, so we're looking at the village sites. And the house that Sathlawa was born in was burned down, unfortunately, I think in the 1960s. But you can still see the foundations of the house, you can still see where the cellar was, and you can still see where the animal pens were and so on. There's still fruit trees there. But all you have to do is put one shovel in the ground and you see that underlying Sathlawa's home is several thousand years of history. Present in what you see here in these rich black shell-rich shellman sediments that go back several thousand years. There are root gardens, like Wilfred George. He's holding a handful of these Pacific silverweed and springbank clover rhizomes. This is a landscape that is, in all my experience, probably my 25 years of doing archaeology and ethnoecology, this is the landscape that is the most heavily managed. Lekwungen people used fire to create these open grassy savannas, and ecological remnants of the savannas are still there. There were three major village sites. We actually just found one 2 weeks ago, which we didn't know about, with some students doing an ethnoecology field school. And the houses are about 50 meters long and about 30 or 40 meters wide. And probably go back several thousand years. Just as a ballpark estimate, if those three villages are contemporaneous, there was about 1,000 people at any given time living at Clichés, this really small archipelago. So we have this mosaic of villages, of blue camas gardens, of this fire-maintained ecosystem, the springbank clover, root gardens. There, of course, there are burial sites. There's culturally modified trees, and so on. And I think one of the lessons that I'd like to share with you before I go tonight is that Clichys is only a snapshot, a small part of what was at one time a much larger Lekwungen landscape. Cadbrough Bay, Beacon Hill Park, you know, all of Greater Victoria was like Clichys, intensely managed. And the landscape, the signs of this Lekwungen inhabitation are still there. Particularly in the springtime, you see the canvas come up, and every bay has these remnants of these village sites and so on. One of the last things I'd like to tell you about is the value of Clichys to the community today. It's a place where children and elders can go, and so we've been going out in the summertime to kind of do the deep hanging out, that valuable kind of time on the land together, where scientists and elders and kids can come together and talk about plants, talk about history, and also to talk about the hopes and dreams for the island. We're at a time now where we are working together as a group of scientists and indigenous peoples to think about what Clichys will mean to the Songhees people in the future. Oops. So I just like to say before I go that I encourage you the next time you go for a walk to actually start thinking about this deep history of the landscape. Think about the village sites, and next time you see blue camas, sit down, enjoy that blue camas, think about that plant entangled in these rich, vibrant social connections and relationships, and that this is part of an ecosystem that has come into being over many thousands of years, and that the way that we treat blue camas, and the way that we treat these village sites, and the way that we treat this broad spectrum of Lekwungen landscape speaks volumes about how we treat the descendants of those people today. Thank you very much.
Darcy Matthews, everybody. Thank you for sharing your blue camas experience, and I think that's a powerful invitation to all of us to have our own and to start to really see the land that we're living on in a different way. So thank you for that. It's very powerful. Our next presenter is Elizabeth Gugel, and she is studies family economics, an area that investigates issues such as family formation and dissolution, fertility decisions, investments in children, altruism in families, and gender inequality in relationships. Today, she's presenting on a topic that I deal with a lot, and it's called A Prosperous Region Needs a Vibrant Core. Please give it up for Elizabeth, everybody.
Probably the most colorful of my presentation. And I think when you see how I tell a story, you will also understand why economics is the dismal science in social sciences. I only have one picture with people on it, and the rest is a lot more abstract. Nonetheless, I'm talking about all of us today. I myself live in Saanich, and work at the University of Victoria, which is partly in Oak Bay and partly in Saanich. And my husband works in Taunton, Victoria. My children are growing up here, and I hope that one day they will, well, hopefully, they will stay somewhere in the capital region. And so what I want to talk about today is a joint research with one of my colleagues and two students, where we were looking into some of the obstacles in the capital region that we face because we have 13 municipalities. There's my picture of people. Lots of them. And it's also making the point that very often the city of Victoria is receiving a lot of people who actually are not residents of Victoria. We rely on the city of Victoria to provide the whole region with cultural events. And as the central business and entertainment district, a lot of people will be going to Victoria at any given point in time. So let me just show you these two graphs here. The big picture of these two is that there are arrows going from different municipalities to other municipalities. And the point I want to make is that a lot of us in the capital region basically consider ourselves as residents of the capital region, but not particularly one of the municipalities, in the sense that everything we do is just in this one municipality and we never get out of it. Instead, there are many ways in which we go from one municipality to the other. But our political structure in the capital region is not reflecting that. Instead, we have these 13 municipalities, and they are often, in the way they set their policies, not really taking into account the region as a whole. Okay, just to kind of explain these two graphs a little bit more, bigger arrows means more people are moving from one municipality to the other. And whether you go with weekday work trips or whether you look at Saturday recreational trips, what you can see is that a lot of arrows are pointing towards the city of Victoria, and they tend to be bigger or thicker than the ones that are pointing out. Okay, so that means that there's a lot of stuff going on in the city of Victoria, which on the other hand only has 22% of the residents of the whole capital region. And why is this important? Well, I want to step a little bit back away from our capital region and just tell you a more abstract story, because this is what economists do. We tell very abstract stories, but then we actually put them back in and we make policy recommendations and we think about the people. What we have here is, imagine there's this nice land, nobody is there, people see that it's very nice, and so they're showing up, okay? And they start to grow a city. And so at the beginning and all the way until we have filled up all the circle, what happens is that as more people come, they also are locating within the political boundaries of that region, and therefore, as the public services that are being provided by that local government and the need for funding increases, the people who are coming in are also paying through their property taxes and therefore fund the expansion. So often what happens is then when we think about local government in general, people always think, oh, they tax us and that's bad. But they also provide a lot of good stuff. And especially on the local level, we know that they do, right? I mean, Symphony Splash is nice. They provide public safety for us. There are recreational centers and so on and so forth. But of course, in order to provide public services, we also need a tax base that pays for it. And so when the jurisdictional boundaries of the provision of services does not match the tax base, then we have a problem with sustainability. And so as you see this area grow, you can imagine the following situation. So we have filled in this circle with, you know, moderate density, and then people are thinking, well, what happens if we locate just outside? Then we're not subject to taxation of the core, but we can still go in and benefit from the services that are provided. And if that happens, what happens, there are two things happening simultaneously. On the one hand, we have a problem. I should be looking at this screen than this one. I was not paying attention when Jeremy gave our lecture. So what is the problem with this is that, as I said, usually when you provide services that are proportionate to your population, as the population grows within your boundaries, you also get more revenues, and then you can match your services to the growing population. If most of the population is now growing outside of your jurisdictional boundaries, but they're still coming into the city and rely on your services, then we have a mismatch between, on the one hand, what you should be providing for the region, and on the other hand, what the city of Victoria can actually afford because it's taxing the residents. And so, with this in mind, basically what I want to appeal to you today, and as I said, I live in Saanich, and so with amalgamation, my taxes would probably go up. I do think there's a benefit of actually putting our region on a better footing and a better decision-making process by having basically the boundaries of the region also match the political boundaries, so that we are all paying in into the local funds in order to make the best of our region. I just give you one more example of how at the moment we have a problem. So when we look at the Capital Regional District, then they have a growth plan for the region, and some of that envisions that actually more business centers are going to be located outside of the city of Victoria. But at the same time, they envision that the city of Victoria is going to stay the cultural center of the region. Now, cultural events, they require a lot of money. And when you take away the business that is actually taxed at a higher tax rate than residents, you take away a lot of the tax base. So if the money is not coming from the businesses that are then located someplace else, we can't have that kind of regional planning where we have the businesses outside of Victoria, but we want all the nice cultural events in Victoria. Okay? I also want to just to kind of drive home how important Victoria is to all of us. If you think about the political events, surely because the legislature is in Victoria, people would be gathering there to protest or to celebrate. But there was this march in solidarity for the March of Women in Washington, D.C. that was held not too long ago, a day after the inauguration of Donald Trump. And people could have gathered anywhere in the capital region to do that, right? There's no point in terms of, you know, protesting or marching in front of City Hall in Victoria, because City Hall has nothing to do with what was happening. But of course we all went to Victoria, because this is the focal point of the region, right? But we need to take care of our core in order for all of us to experience a good regional role. Okay, and so just one last picture. So if we don't, then this happens. And the core contracts, we get, you know, empty storefronts in the core, and it makes it feel more desolate than it has to be. Victoria and the Greater Victoria Area, the capital region, is actually an outlier within regions in Canada. And so this last graph is showing you how with the increase in population, we also tend to see an increase in municipalities in the region, but nothing like we have in Victoria. And so just let me give you two examples. Toronto is over here, which we know as a mega city, right? So there's only one municipality and everybody lives in that, in Toronto. We also know that Vancouver has a lot of different municipalities, and so in my chart that would be over here. So Vancouver is relatively large in terms of its population size, and then it also has a lot of municipalities. But the capital region is down here. We don't have a lot of people in the capital region, and yet we have 30 municipalities. So we are way off the trend when it comes to regions and the municipal structure. And it's not even Victoria that everybody associates with the region that is the municipality with the largest share of population. That would be Saanich with 30% of the population, and the city of Victoria only has 22%.
Give it up for Elizabeth, everybody. as a Victoria City Councillor, I'd like to thank you for your presentation. And no mention of parking, that's also nice. Our next presenter, also our last presenter of the evening, and then you will have a chance to ask some questions of the presenters, which should be, that'll be very interesting. I look forward to your questions and I look forward to the answers. So our final presenter is Sarah Marie Weeb. And Sarah is a social scientist focusing on creative public engagement and environmental justice. She is part of several collaborative mixed media storytelling research projects with Indigenous community partners. Her book, Everyday Exposure, Indigenous Mobilization and Environmental Justice, was recently published by UBC Press. And her presentation tonight is called Light and Shadows, Narrating Youth Engagement in Attawapiskat. I think are we starting with a film?
You'll do.
Okay. Give it up for Sarah, everybody.
Thanks, Jeremy. Thanks for the warm welcome, and thanks for staying with me and with us to the end here. I'm pleased to have the last word, and I'll be giving the last word to the youth from Attawapiskat who will round out our time together this evening. So I'm Sarah Marie Weeb, a settler Canadian who grew up in Coast Salish territory along the Burrard Inlet on a body of water called the Indian Arm. And I'm currently teaching political science, and my interests are in social science and public engagement, political ecology, and environmental justice. And I'm really, really passionate about thinking through how we can use the arts as ways of communicating across difference, and how the arts can be ways in which we address issues around environmental injustice and also engage the senses as we're doing that. So today I'll be presenting some stories from the youth from Attawapiskat as part of a project called the Reimagining Attawapiskat Project, and I'm so delighted that some of my collaborators are here, Caruso and Aaron, who've been part of this project. It's a short project that evolved out of my postdoc research, and it's a collaboration between Indigenous and non-Indigenous artists who share an interest in thinking about questions around treaty relations and colonization, and trying to improve some of the health inequities that we're seeing. So together we collaborated with the high school in Attawapiskat and hosted a series of digital storytelling workshops. And so what I'm going to share is sort of the culmination of a few of the stories produced by the youth in the community. But I wanted to just give a little bit of context and also share further about what I mean by mixed media storytelling and why I think this is a valuable approach for social science research. So in my view, mixed media storytelling has three main components, and the first is trying to interrogate mainstream media narratives. And I was really struck by a lot of the media coverage of Attawapiskat over the years in light of the ongoing state of emergency declarations, and also the way in which the media continued to frame the community as in crisis. And I thought to myself that this can't be the only story about the community. Surely there must be other stories. And so as a team, we set out to investigate these stories. The second part of mixed media storytelling, in my view, is about creating dialogue. So I'm hopeful that we can have some dialogue tonight about the value in using these techniques to have conversations about really difficult topics. And then the third component of mixed media storytelling to me is about intervening back on those mainstream narratives with counter stories and youth stories and grassroots stories to try to restore some balance or address the inequities that we see in storytelling. And so we set out to look at how we could talk about and think about Attawapiskat as more than a community in crisis. And as we were in the community brainstorming and thinking about what stories youth wanted to tell, the theme of reimagining Attawapiskat came up over and over again. So you'll see in the video the youth sharing what their vision of Attawapiskat looks like and what this community means to them. And so I'd like us to think about, you know, what can we learn from the youth of Attawapiskat as political subjects, as people with agency and voice, and a lot to teach us about some of our own ignorances, some of the things that we don't know anything about. And in this sense, I think that research can contribute to a process of dialogue and engage in a conversation about reconciliation. So hopefully we'll have a bit of time to chat about what that looks like. And I guess the last thing that I want to say before showing the video is I was also really struck by the context in which former Chief Teresa Spence was seeking recognition of a treaty relationship. And this was part of her narrative and her story when engaging with political figures through her hunger strike. And so I asked this question, and I hope that we'll come back to it in terms of what does it mean to be in a treaty relationship today. So with that, I'll hand it over to the youth of Attawapiskat, and we'll hear their vision for what that looks like.
What do you see? What do you know? Oppression is not our only story. We are strong, we are resilient. We have the potential to overcome challenges in our life. Let me tell you the true stories.
Before the humans came to live upon the earth, only the animals, the birds, and the fishes lived on it.
I love this place. It's where I find myself. It's why I choose the trees, the water, the rocks, the grass, the branches, the leaves, everything, the animals. This is where I be myself.
One day, a couple of sky people, that is a man and his wife, were wandering about in their land. They heard a voice talking to them, but they could see no one. Do you wish to see another world? Inquired the voice. Yes, said the couple.
We have some really beautiful spots in this town. Like, it's not all ugly. It can be really beautiful. You can have a good time here. Like, all this nature and all the beauty around the community, in the community. Even the people here are, like, really great too. They don't really see much of that on the news or, like, on the internet. They don't really cover it. It's not cover all, like, all the negativity with the suicide crisis. It's not always like that here. Like, it's fun, people are laughing and smiling, and it's home.
The sky couple began to have children and entered the organ of humans.
I really like to see the young ones, the infants, the youth, to really catch up with the teachings and reestablish what we must. Good mind, good thoughts.
I only know a little, but I know there's more. Many stories behind these. It'll take a lifetime for me to understand. I'm only 17, and have many years ahead of me to understand.
Thank you to Sarah Marie Weeb and the youth of Attawapiskat for sharing your story and their story today. And I think that's a great way to end. So let's give it one more time for can we give one round of applause for all the presenters tonight? It was amazing. And we have time for just a few questions, and I think they can be for any of the presenters. So there's a mic here if anyone wants, or you can stand up and raise your voice if you have. Yeah?
I don't need a mic.
Great.
This question is for anyone. I was wondering what was the process like of transforming your research into a story, and what were the scary parts and exciting parts?
passing it off to Jim Tanaka.
That's a great question. I think as faculty, we're so used to presenting our lectures, our research, we're really comfortable with that. But at the workshop, what Jeremy challenged us to do is to reveal something about ourselves, to be vulnerable. And I think that was sort of the main sort of challenge, and that's really hard. So we had a lot of discussions about that. That is, are there limits to vulnerability, it was interesting because I think a lot of our stories changed from the work. We came in with some set ideas based on trotting out the same or similar kind of research that we do, but I think a lot of those stories morphed and changed when we brought them tonight.
Thanks, Jim. Does anyone else want to comment on that?
No.
All right, we've got a question.
I have a question. Question for Darcy. You seem to be pretty entrenched in the First Nations community you're talking to. Do you have much contact with them before, or is this all new? I can't even tell. When Jim's talked about the face, I don't know if you have any First Nations within you.
Just for the camera, which is filming this. I don't know if you want to repeat the question and then answer.
Okay, thank you for your question. So my father is Cree and my mother is a settler. I certainly learned to inhabit both worlds. My experience here in Victoria goes back 20 years. And to be honest, I didn't actually expect to end up in Victoria for any length of time. I came here for work, to actually work with the Songhees Nation, working with the chief when he was much younger and doing cultural work for his community. And I mean, to be honest, I didn't even get into archaeology to work with the Indigenous peoples of Canada. I wanted to study Egypt. And I started to learn about the cultures, and I'm certainly working with the Songhees over 20 years. Again, that's what I mean, it's that entangling kind of thing, that you build these relationships with people. They are kind enough to share with you. I'm reminded of the first elder I worked with in Victoria, Simon Smith Sr., and I just had the pleasure of having lunch with him a couple of weeks ago, and he reminded me of this, and I'd actually forgotten this, that those communities invest an incredible amount in us. And one of the challenges of this is to actually expose that some of the personal aspects, there are personal relationships here that are at work. And those personal relationships, at least in my work, they inform the actual research question and they inform the methodologies. And this challenges us to take what is a dichotomous kind of way of thinking about the world. You have a Western worldview and an Indigenous one, or scientific and Indigenous one, and to actually find a way where you find harmony between the two. And I think out of that, much more interesting questions arise that are respectful to the values of the community, but also produce really good and exciting science.
And here, I'll just give you the mic.
I have a question. It's probably for Elizabeth. And many of the themes that we've been talking about, or that the presenters talked about, have to do with relationship building. And one of the things that comes up when we talk about amalgamation, and I do understand, I live in Oak Bay, and they're underfunded. They can't seem to fix their sidewalks or their potholes or do anything, because they don't have, despite the wealth that might live there, they don't have a good tax base. But I wonder, in these big mega cities, how does relationship, do the kinds of relationships that you can develop in a smaller municipality, do they get lost when you get into the bigger municipality? And so this, most of the themes that I'm listening to from the presenters have to do with the importance of relationship building, even maybe with the algae in the water, at least being able to recognize the color, So I think that's a concern about amalgamation is that I know people in City Hall, but when I was in Vancouver, I didn't know, of course I was much younger, I didn't know anybody. So how do you maintain that opportunity to become involved in your community when you're in this big mega city, and what does economics How does economics deal with the relationships?
Yeah, so there are two things. And so the last chart that I showed was where I mentioned Toronto. And of course, Toronto has a huge population. But when we look at, and one of the points I was trying to make is that even if we amalgamated, the capital region in terms of population is still fairly small compared to what we have in these other, like in the mega city when we think of something like Toronto. When we think about, so economics, I think when we think about levels of government, we try to match the problems that the government is trying to solve with the sphere of impact. And so you do want to have, so for example, homelessness is not just something that happens on one street in Victoria. This is actually something that the region as a whole should embrace and try to find solutions to. When you think about affordable housing, the idea is that I think everybody says, yes, we need more, but then in each municipality, if they put something, a project in, where there's affordable housing, the municipalities are also worried about what is this doing to my deck space, but because I could have a developer coming in, and then I get the property taxes. And so just as you can be too big in terms of the level on which you're trying to make decisions and then forget about smaller communities, you can also be too small when you sometimes make political decisions. And I think in the case of the capital region, it's the problem that we are too small. In terms of, I think there's, so as I mentioned the capital region growth plan, and that actually is one that envisions to have more shopping, well, so centers of commerce also outside of the city of Victoria. And if the deck space is shared in the region, then this is possible. So we can actually have more little pockets of communities and centers if we share the revenues, because then in the city of Victoria, it can take care of things like, you know, housing more non-for-profit organizations and putting on more cultural events. So I don't think that amalgamation in our case, where we are talking about something like 300,000 people, would actually get in the way of also preserving neighborhood characters. I think both can be achieved at the same time.
Thank you, and we've got one last question, and you've already got the mic.
So I just wanted to thank all of the panelists for speaking and sharing your stories. I really appreciate visual storytelling and stories. I think that it's often undervalued in terms of, you know, how we value knowledge and knowledge production within the university. And I feel happy to say that I've so far weaseled my way this far along in my education with storytelling. And I really wanted to raise my hands to all of you in this work, because I really believe that stories also have the capacity to transcend the academic sphere and really settle itself in the communities, and most often in the communities in which these stories come from. And just in thinking, you know, it's something that has been kind of touched upon in most of the stories shared today, but something that I was reflecting upon was the use of Indigenous research methodologies and how it really has been used in a lot of, you know, whether explicitly or not, used to really guide a lot of these relationships and relationship building in this type of research. So kind of I was in reflection to the first question, something I was thinking about is for other students, including myself, who is seeking to do research in a way which is based upon relationships and kind of contrasts traditional, colonial research, which is often used to extract information, but instead recenter community as partners and collaborators within the stories that we tell. I would really encourage folks to check out Indigenous research methodologies as a guiding protocol in how to do that beyond Indigenous communities, but really can be utilized in all types of research. So I raise my hands for your work and congratulations for tonight.
Thank you. And great. So Dean Krull is going to have the last word.
Yeah, I realized I was so busy introducing everybody and the team and whatnot, I forgot to actually say who I was. So I'm Kathy Krull, and I have the privilege of being the Dean of Social Sciences. And I have to say, you know, I'm never, ever, you know, prepared for the talent that I see when I come to their presentations. Congratulations, all of you. Thank you very much for all the work you put into this. Thank you, Jeremy, for doing a great job at moderating the game and for helping our team. I'd also like to ask Anne to stand. She's our invisible person, but she's the person that made all of this happen. So thank you, Anne. And thank you to all of you for coming tonight.